So I will also have a lot of the same general slides for the first few slides. And I think what you'll see here is, you know, this TTC concept has been around for quite a long time. Hopefully I'll provide just a slightly different perspective. And to kick it off, before I start even saying anything about flavors, I just want to put this slide up, which is to say, you know, this is essentially what we'd like to do for pretty much every flavoring substance if it was a perfect world. So on the right side of the slide, we would do a tox study of some type, right? And we would feed our substances to a bunch of animals, and we would identify some dose level where we didn't see anything that was adverse, right? So a no observed adverse effect level. And then knowing what we would know about the exposure to the substance, we'd be able to then say, well, you know, let's apply an appropriate safety factor. If that exposure is at or below an acceptable level of intake, we don't have any concerns at all, right? So that would be really nice. The reality is we have a lot of flavoring substances, about 3,000 different flavoring substances out there. Some of them are natural flavoring complexes. We're not entirely sure how we would test some of them because specifications can be very widely different between different companies. The other issue is a lot of these flavoring substances, as Mitch mentioned earlier, are used at extremely low levels. And so to even do, say, a 90-day study wouldn't just require, a company to supply a sample. It would essentially require the entire global industry to give all of that flavoring substance to a contract lab to do the work, because that's how small some of these substances are in terms of use. On a yearly basis for some of them, total global usage can be somewhere in the ballpark of, less than 1 kilogram. So this is what we'd like to say. We'd like to be able to show this for each and every substance and say, yeah, we have a good NOEL value. We're never going to get there. And so we have to figure out strategically and soundly how we can, identify safe levels of intake for flavoring substances. And what I'm going to talk about are a couple of different approaches that sort of get at that same issue. So Mitch and Penelope have talked a little bit about the Kramer Ford Hall decision tree publication. I'd like everybody to spend the next 5 minutes just reading this, and I'll just wait. Let's cut to the chase. So really, the Kramer Ford Hall decision tree said, well, we have a problem here. We need some tox data to set priorities to do more testing, but we need priorities to decide what sort of testing to do. Now, those of you that were in the morning session where Dr. Forgas spoke, they're looking at some of these, I think, really novel methods to start setting these priorities using TOX-21, TOX-Cas type data. Back in 1978, the idea of high throughput screening was, I don't think, really in anybody's minds. And so as an alternative, what the Kramer-Ford Hall decision tree said was, why don't we, instead of just relying purely on expert judgment and some, learned academics saying, well, this is probably a substance that we have to worry about, so let's do some tox testing. They said, as an alternative, let's develop a decision tree. We'll make it public, it'll be very clear, very explicit what the limitations are, and we'll try and use that to identify what the priority setting standards should be for testing of materials. This is what the Kramer-Ford Hall decision tree looks like. We, again, won't obviously go into any specific details, but you start at the very top, question one. Is it a common component of food? That's really the first question. And you can see you sort of work down the tree, and at different places throughout the tree, you would come out into decision tree class one, decision tree class two, or decision tree class three. If you look at it from a chemical perspective, it's organized generally into different chemical classes. At some point, there's a branch that heads down towards heterocyclics, and another place, a branch that heads towards open chains, aromatics, heteroaromatics, et cetera. This publication in 1978 at the time, Food and Cosmetics Toxicology, obviously has had a tremendous influence. The class structures, as Mitch mentioned earlier, class one, class two, and class three, class one being the class of low order of oral toxicity concern, Low priority for investigation, class three high priority for investigation, and then class two sort of that middle ground. We've talked a little bit already about how Ian Monroe established the fifth percentile NOEL, and I won't go into any substantial detail here other than to point out that what that's really allowed us to do then is to define these very specific and clear thresholds for class one, class two, and class three, essentially saying 1,800 micrograms per person per day, 540 and 90 micrograms per person per day, respectively, for class one, class two, and class three. If you're below that level, then you presumably have a low concern for toxic concern. If you're above it, then you don't. And then the question really becomes, well, what do you do then? Do you do testing? Do you look at something else? So that's the background. We've already covered this now in two previous talks. What we haven't talked about is flavors in any substantial way. So I'm going to try and run through flavors in about a minute, which I'm sure my flavor industry colleagues would be kind of aghast at this point, but that's about the amount of time I want to spend on it. Flavors, in the big picture, when we talk about strawberry flavor, lime flavor, anything, what we're really talking about are compounded flavors. Compounded flavors are those, you know, bottles or jars or 55-gallon drums that are composed of a plethora of individual flavoring substances. Okay? Individual flavoring substances typically are either single chemically defined flavoring substances. On the right side of the slide, I have citronellal as one example, myrcene and limonene as three different examples, or natural flavor complexes. And these are very complex mixtures that have all sorts of different ingredients, including, in the case of lime oil, citronellal, myrcene, and limonene, among other components. Flavor companies, the flavor industry, traditionally sells compounded flavors, for instance, a lime flavor. They generate these flavors. These are what end up in the consumer products. And so, for instance, you'd start off potentially as a flavor house with a mixture of some chemically defined substances like citronellal or myrcene or limonene, potentially with a lime oil or an extract or a distillate. You generate a compounded flavor. That compounded flavor ends up in a consumer product, in this case, a lime-flavored potato chip. Now, if this works and it works well, then the consumer eats it and thinks, wow, this tastes like lime, right? That's perfect world. But what that means is, and where the flavor industry is sort of internally competitive, is these compounded flavors are the intellectual property and are the artistic output of the flavor industry. And what that really means then is that the flavor industry wouldn't like to have four crayons to play with. They'd like to have as many as possible. Because the larger the palette of flavoring substances that you have to work with, the more different compounded flavors that you can generate. Different flavor houses can generate all sorts of different lime flavors. When I started with the flavor industry now about 10 years ago, I visited Givaudan Flavors, which is the largest flavor company. And I distinctly remember going in and smelling 50 different mushroom flavors that they had created that morning. And you could really tell the differences between them. And that's just the ability to either change the ratio of different flavoring substances or to add in, you know, flavoring substance A through Z, and then double A through double Z, et cetera. So the palette, how big is it? Well, right now there are about 2,800 flavoring substances that are considered generally recognized as safe in the United States by the expert panel of the Flavor and Extract Manufacturers Association. That's a lot of substances. It's a lot of safety evaluations. How do we get there? Well, we got through the FEMAGRAS program. This is the safety evaluation program that's already been described as a sort of an artifact or side effect of the 1958 Food Additives Amendment that described a specific carve-out for GRAS substances that removed them from traditional food additive petition requirements. This is a safety evaluation program based on expert evaluation, expert based on scientific training and experience. The FEMA expert panel is industry supported, but scientifically independent. The safety evaluation, as Mitch mentioned, is based on rigorous scientific procedures and very well-defined criteria that have been published in the open literature. And the safety is under conditions of intended use. Conditions of intended use in this particular case only as flavor ingredients. The FEMA expert panel doesn't evaluate the substance per se. They evaluate the use of the substance as a flavoring ingredient. The FEMA GRAS program also has an ongoing monitoring program to understand human exposure and changes therein. This is itself a way to prioritize flavoring substances for further evaluation or potentially for additional studies. And there's a regular and periodic reevaluation process as well. So why has this program worked? As was already mentioned, exposure to flavors is pretty low. So typically, you know, and the number will vary a little bit from period to period, but for about 70% of grass flavoring substances, the exposure is actually less than the 1.5 microgram per kilogram body weight per day level. And the use, as mentioned, is self-limiting. If you go above a certain threshold, a lot of flavors become very disgusting or very nauseous very quickly. A lot of flavors are very similar, and this can then result in very well-defined structural classes. You can group, for instance, simple esters together. You can group menthol-related substances together. And again, we have a long-standing expert panel. It's been in existence now for more than 50 years with flexible but well-defined criteria. Now, why else has the FEMA grass program worked? It's worked because we've been at it a long time. The panel has been in operation formally since 1965. FEMA, as an association, began developing information on flavoring substance in a formal capacity since 1960. And so essentially in that first five-year period, the FEMA expert panel began to look at 1,300 different flavors and then ultimately published those in what we call the GRASS III publication. Over the next 50 years, roughly an additional 1,500 flavors have been reviewed. So the panel's been able to look at roughly 30 flavors per year, sometimes more, sometimes less, but they've been at it a long time. They've been able to sort of stretch their legs and spend some time looking at flavors. As you're going to see, not everybody's been able to do that, and that's why we require some innovative approaches like the TTC. The expert panel evaluation is not significantly different than any other sort of safety evaluation. It relies on understanding the identity of the substance, understanding the potential metabolism, the biological fate in the body, and then also looking at the toxicity. What is the target organ for toxicity? Is the substance does it display genotoxic potential in vitro? What do we know in vivo? What sort of subchronic toxicity data? Is there CART data available? The data that's looked at by the FEMA expert panel, it's not just for the substance. As Penelope mentioned earlier with the FDA's review, it's also for all structure-related materials. And so the panel takes very similar approaches to the FDA in terms of looking out into the literature for structure-related substances. This is ultimately, obviously, a GRASS evaluation, safety evaluation using expert judgment. So I've now spent probably about half my time, and I've hardly mentioned the TTC. So really, where does the TTC fit into flavors? Well, when we're talking about single chemically defined substances, the vast majority of expert panel GRASS evaluations are pre-market evaluations. They're single substance evaluations. And this decision tree class and this TTC concept, they're factors. But really, the panel relies on an appropriate margin of safety based on anticipated exposure versus a no observed adverse effect level. And so, and again, under conditions of intended use as a flavoring ingredient. The panel looks at the decision tree class sort of as a quick rule of thumb to say, well, you know, we think that, or we would agree that this, you know, fits well into class three. Maybe we should be ensuring that we have appropriate tox data. They also look at the TTC concept to understand whether more careful exposure scrutiny would be required. But in terms of the primary safety evaluation, again, specifically for chemically defined substances, uses flavorings, the panel really doesn't use the decision tree or the TTC in a rigorous way in this initial evaluation. Again, they're factors, but they're not the decision. So really, where does this TTC concept fit into flavor safety evaluation? I'm going to give you two sort of practical examples. The first is the FEMA expert panel evaluation of natural flavor complexes. So we just spent some time talking about chemically defined substances, those individual materials like myrcene or citronellal or limonene. How does the panel look at natural flavor complexes? And then secondly, the JECFA evaluation of flavoring substances. So in terms of the FEMA expert panel use of TTCs for natural flavor complexes, this is the panel statement. The panel has recently adopted these thresholds recently as of 2005, for their application of the safety evaluation of natural flavor complexes. And essentially what this means is they're now using the TTC concept within the safety evaluation of NFCs. And I'll show you exactly how this works. So, panel's natural flavor complex evaluations requires the constituents to be identified. For a natural flavor complex, this could vary between tens of substances to hundreds of substances within a natural flavor complex. These are often very, very complex materials. And they will assign a decision tree class and apply the TTC concept to related groups of substances. For instance, a group of, say, menthol-related materials. They'll calculate exposure, they'll determine decision tree class for each and every constituent within that group, and then they'll apply both a group intake and a group decision tree class, the most conservative decision tree class. If the group intake collectively is below the TTC, then the panel would say, for that specific group within the natural flavor complex, we have no concerns. If the group intake is above the TTC, then they would ask for additional information. It may be a study for one of the key constituents within the NFC within that group. It may be data that's already available for a structure-related substance. What this really does is it provides a constituent-based, rapid, and rigorous approach to both sort and then also prioritize chemical groups of substances within a natural flavor complex. In terms of what this actually looks like, this is a very, very abbreviated table, but take corn mint oil, which is an alternative to some of the other mints that are out there. If you look at it from a group approach, I've just shown three of the, I think there's probably something like eight or nine different chemical groups total within corn mint oil, but terpene hydrocarbons, secondary allocyclic alcohols and ketones, and then isopropylidene alpha beta ketones. So three chemical groups. I've pointed out a few constituents within each. Within the group of terpene hydrocarbons, limonene and pinene are two examples. The group of terpene hydrocarbons, about 5 to 8% total of corn mint oil. The daily per capita intake of that group from corn mint oil as an NFC when used as a flavoring substance is a little bit less than 1,600 micrograms per person per day. The most conservative decision tree class is class one for that group. And so then the panel asked the question, is the intake less than the TTC for structural class of the group? Again, assigned based on the most conservative. In this particular case, the answer is yes. The intake is less than 1,800 micrograms per person per day. And so in this particular case, a NOEL is not required. Now, as it turns out, we have NOELs for pinene, we have NOELs for limonene, et cetera. But from a formal perspective, the panel is essentially saying, we don't have any concern about this group within this NFC. That's not the case for the others. The secondary allocyclic alcohol and ketone group, signature notes there, menthol and menthone. This is the vast majority of corn oil, makes up 90 to 95% of it. The intake is very high, around 19,000 micrograms per person per day. The structural class, decision tree class, is class two for the most conservative one there. And then obviously 19,000 is considerably greater than 540, which is the TTC cutoff for structural class two. And therefore, NOEL would be required. In this particular case, there's a NOEL of about 200 milligrams per kilogram body weight per day for one of the constituents, which allows the panel to assign a margin of safety of roughly 1,000 based on that intake of 19,000. And then similarly, isopropylidene alpha beta ketone, pulagon and methafuran, two substances I think that many of you may recognize as being a particular toxic concern. This is, again, in corn mint oil, a very small amount of the total, but the intake is still there. It's about 400 micrograms per person per day. These are definitely allocated within structural class three, and the intake is greater than 90 micrograms per person per day for structural class three. It's 400. And again, NOELs would be required, and we do have them for both pulagon and methylfuran. The only other thing I'll mention here is the TTC concept is applied by the panel for unknowns as well within natural flavor complexes. And so the panel approach there is to take the unknowns to estimate intake based on the total amount of unknown that's present, to assign it automatically into structural class three because they have no idea what the toxic potential could be, so they assume it's the worst. And then they ask the question, is there something appropriate that we could assign as a NOEL? Now, in this particular case, we actually have a NOEL from corn mint oil itself. And so that is 5 milligrams per kilogram body weight per day, which provides a safety factor of about 100. So that's the panel approach. As I said, the female expert panel has been working on this since 1960 to 1965. Around the same time, the JECFA, the UN-WHO Joint Expert Committee on Food Additives, also launched flavor safety evaluations. So, and I'm not doing this to make a dig at JECFA, but the panels looked at about 2,800 flavoring substances over the years. By 1995, JECFA had looked at 70. And so there was a pretty big difference, obviously, in terms of you know, you could say productivity, but I won't say that, because the problem is the JECFA approach was that they required an acceptable daily intake approach for each and every flavoring substance. They were looking at them substance by substance, and there's just not enough toxicity data out there to do this. If JECFA were to sort of move along at that pace, it would take them 1,000 years to complete flavor safety evaluations. And so really a new approach is necessary. And this is a lot of the work, obviously, that's already been mentioned related to what Ian Monroe and others have done. It's a new JECFA approach to evaluate flavoring substances, new in this case, meaning since 1995. It uses toxicological principles that were initially elaborated by JECFA. It precludes the need for tox data on all flavoring substances. It organizes substances using a chemical group approach again. So they look at a whole range of substances that are structurally related within the same meeting, within, in the case of JECFA, the same monograph, but they're still looking at the individual material. And again, it makes use of the TTC concept. How does this work, and why is it appropriate? Again, flavors are simple, generally. In many cases, the metabolism is pretty well characterized. In most cases, the exposure is low. As Mitch said, many of these are naturally occurring or very, very closely related to naturally occurring substances. And so JECFA took the supposition that, in general, most flavors could be predicted to be harmless in many cases, which they felt made it appropriate then to be able to apply a TTC concept. The basic approach, which I really won't go into in any great depth, is again a TTC approach based on Kramer classification, understanding metabolic fate, toxicity, exposure. This is not unique to JECFA, it's not unique to the expert panel. This is essentially the way, obviously, the flavor safety evaluation and most food additive evaluation is done almost anywhere in the world. If you look at the Kramer classifications that JECFA has done, for flavoring substances, what you see is about 66% of flavoring substances fall into class 1, about 20% in class 2, and about 15% into class 3. That, you know, not a huge surprise. For the class 3 substances, we have some materials that, you know, the metabolism couldn't be well predicted. There was some concern based on structural alert. But a lot of flavoring substances are just really, really simple materials, and they easily allocate into class 1. Now, we could spend, you know, easily another hour talking about the JECFA procedure, but this is what the JECFA procedure for flavoring substances looks like. And you start at the very top, and the first thing they say is, what's the decision tree class, the Kramer-Ford-Hall decision tree class? So you assign that, and then the second question they ask is it metabolized to innocuous products? Can you predict, based on expert judgment, based on available data, that the substance metabolizes in a let's say, a good way? If the answer to that is yes, then you go down what's called the A side of the JECFA procedure, going to question A3. If the answer to that, you cannot metabolize to innocuous products, is no, then you go down the B side. In either case, you ask the question, is the exposure greater than TTC for the structural class? For class 1, it's 1,800 micrograms per person per day. For class 2, 540. For class 3, 90. And you can sort of see how it works down. Essentially, what it's really doing throughout is saying, well, okay, if the exposure is greater than the threshold of concern, what do you know about the substance in terms of the metabolism? And what do you know potentially about the toxicity of the material or for related materials? Can you establish an appropriate margin of safety? But importantly, if the exposure is on the A side, if the exposure is not greater than the threshold of concern for class, then automatically JECFA just says, fine, we don't have any need to really look at this any further. Now, on the B side, if the exposure is greater than threshold of concern for class, they're pretty much automatically going to ask for additional data. Down the B side, because you can't predict metabolism to innocuous product, if the exposure is not greater than the TTC, they'd still like to be able to identify a relevant NOEL. Okay, so this question about metabolism is really critical when it comes to JECFA. But their reliance on the TTC concept means that a lot of substances that can go down the A side can automatically be considered no safety concern by the JECFA, just purely based on a TTC question. So the new JECFA procedure for flavors, and again, new based in 1995, really didn't eliminate the need for tox data. What it really provided was a way to complete the safety evaluations for a lot of flavoring substances. And also a way to prioritize important substances for focus, for testing. As a result, since 1995, about 2,000 flavoring substances have been evaluated. JECFA to this point has really only looked at what we call the chemically defined. They haven't looked at these natural flavoring complexes yet. That is a tough nut to crack for JECFA, and we're not there yet. Their conclusions are no safety concern under current conditions of use. And the JECFA findings from these flavor safety evaluations thus far have correlated absolutely to where the FEMA expert panels come out. These are aligned programs in general. Moving forward in terms of, you know, what this means, well, we talked a little bit about the FEMA GRASS program, about the JECFA program. We don't have time to talk about the European Food Safety Authority evaluations within the EU or the Japanese Food Safety Committee evaluations. But what I will note is that, you know, what we can say is that the TTC concept certainly is now being used within the FEMA GRASS program, as I mentioned, for natural flavor complexes. It's being used by the JECFA. Obviously, we just described it there. It's also in use by the EFSA, the European Food Safety Authority, in their new draft guidance document for flavor safety evaluations under the Common Authorization Procedure. Where we don't really see the TTC in use yet is in Japan, which we in the flavor industry would typically refer to as the third sort of global industrialized region. But I will note that the Ministry of Health, Labor, and Welfare is looking at their flavor safety evaluation approaches right now. And we expect that sometime in 2015, we'll see some new approaches that are coming out. We don't know what that means for the TTC use in Japan yet. So that's where we're at. Just two quick slides about what the future might look like. So Penelope mentioned a project that that Tim Adams, as a contractor of the FDA, is looking at. Tim also initiated a project within the flavor industry to look at revising the original Kramer-Ford-Hall decision tree. Question one, normal constituent of body. Question 22, common component of food. These are the types of sort of empirically based questions that you would often then say, well, if I wanted to, you know, adopt a piece of software to make the decision tree as easy as possible, how do I deal with questions like that, right? And there is no simple way to do it other than to establish a lookup list. There is software, by the way, that does this. It's called Toxtree. It's great. It's really come a long way. But we've started to think, you know, why do we even need these questions? If we have a pretty good understanding of metabolism, why do we need to see whether or say whether it's a normal constituent of the body? Wouldn't we assume that if something is endogenous, that it's probably going to, you know, be handled fairly well by metabolism? This question about common component of food, we don't know that that's really a valid question anymore to put in here and to lead to an output of class two. And so we're beginning to add and potentially modify questions to include more chemical classes of compounds. We're adding and modifying questions to ensure compounds with known significant toxicity are appropriately classified. Right now, where we're at in this process, we're a reasonable way down the road, I would say. We have cut the tree back to 29 questions. We're clarifying terminology. We're focusing on ease of use, and we're focusing on validation. But I would say we're also, as Penelope mentioned earlier, extremely sensitive to the fact that this could really have a dramatic impact and would really upset the apple cart. So I think we're doing this very carefully. You know, in terms of updating the decision tree, what this would mean for the TTC concept, well, right now in the current DT, 17 questions would lead to class one or could lead to class one, 14 to class two, and 17 to class three. You know, as the decision tree is revised, what does that mean? You know, will that change the allocation or the outcome of questions into the different decision tree classes? How many decision tree classes are appropriate? Still very much in progress within our industry. I'll note that the WHO put out a call for data or response, I guess I would say, related to their interest in a decision tree TTC concept update. The JECFA, in fact, at their most recent meeting, just noted again that they would like to have some effort to update the TTC concept for use at JECFA. And so we know that there's a lot of groups that are very interested in this. You know, ultimately, all of this work is going to have to either understand or eliminate some of the limitations, I think, that are currently present within the decision tree TTC concept. We've already talked a little bit about some of the other endpoints that haven't been addressed in the current DT classification and TTC concept, for instance, gene tox. So, you know, that's really it. I think at the beginning of my talk, I said, you know, we had this sort of conundrum, right? How do you prioritize without test data? How do you collect test data if you haven't prioritized? I think the nice approach here is the DT, the decision tree, and the TTC concept have been very elegantly used to help set priorities, which have then been used to organize data collection. A lot of that data has been used obviously for flavor safety evaluation, but I think it's now also being used to both refine the decision tree classifications as well as potentially downstream the threshold of toxicological concern concept. So it's, I think Penelope said this is a long range, you know, exploratory project. It absolutely will stay that way for quite a while. This is a huge task, but I think it's an important one. And I think, you know, this feedback loop is one that's going to continue for the long term for flavors. So thank you.